Today's lecture is the screening of a film called Image Before My Eyes, which is essentially a very personalized history of the Jews of Poland. I sent to the entire class in an email discussion questions. How many of you have it? Outstanding. Those of you who don't, you'll have to print it out when you get home. There is one correction. The correction is down at the bottom of the page, and it says, a brief set of typewritten answers to the questions is due in section this week. Cross that out and write next week. We are, I would like to point out to the students that we are honored to have so many people in our lecture hall who are not students of the course, but who have come to partake of what we have to offer. I want to very briefly ask if Crystal is here. Crystal Soto? There's an ASI program on Thursday night. Do you remember where it is?
It's in Warren, it's here.
In Warren Auditorium at 7 o'clock, and it's called the Black Jewish Dialogue. And I think it's going to be a marvelous program. Any of you that can attend it and prove that you did so, either with notes or some other kind of proof, will be able to get dispensation on one of your absences. So, in addition to it being very worthwhile in terms of what you get up here, you also get maybe to sleep in. Why are we going to watch a film about Eastern European or more properly, Polish Jews, the history of Polish Jews between the wars, between World War I and World War II? Well, we have seen and will see again Jewish bodies, places where Jews were turned into ashes, and places where Jews were suffered. I wanted you to see who those people were. And I feel it's very instructive because what it does is help us understand the effects of genocide on humanity. The Jews in Poland had a rich and flourishing culture, and one that still, to a large extent, is remembered, although it has disappeared because of the Holocaust. So, Image Before My Eyes, it is produced and presented by YIVO, which is a YIVO. It's an organization in New York now, but was very, very prominent in Poland, in Vilna, which was known as the Jerusalem of the North. And they did some fabulous work collecting and documenting Jewish culture, which to a large extent no longer exists the way it did in Poland. I have these questions here. Hopefully we'll have a little bit of time to talk about some of them. And without further ado, okay. Excuse me. Could you please turn your computer off? Thank you. And if you've got any phones or anything, you know, turn them off. Okay.
Life is about sound. You know, it's what makes me
Joe, thank you.
Tick as a human.
Could you go through this? This is fast forward.
Joe, could you turn that back on? We need to fast forward it just a bit. This is doesn't have anything to do with the film. There you go. Thank you. Joe, we're okay. Do you see her?
Yeah.
We are going back before the Holocaust, back to the life, the civilization of these Jews of Poland. We want to show not their destruction, but rather a complex society of 3.5 million people with a 900-year history, a society unified by rich traditions, and divided by geography, by social class, by competing hopes, different dreams. We want to show a time of great and rapid changes in that 20-year moment between the two world wars. Of the 3.5 million Jews living in Poland in 1939, all but 250,000 were destroyed by the end of World War II. It is as though we are digging a tunnel back through the Holocaust into the haunted memories of people who were there then. And our tools are boxes of old photographs, half-crumbled posters, a few home movies stored away and often forgotten, scratchy old recordings, all documents of a once vibrant world. World War I has come to an end. Out of the destruction of the war, a fierce sense of nationalism grips the peoples of Europe. All the national groups of Eastern Europe clamor for their rights, either as sovereign nations or as ethnic minorities. The Jews are one of these minorities. In 900 years, they have developed a distinct cultural faith in this region with which they will confront the new era. What is the profile of this faith? For over a century, the Jews, along with the Poles, were ruled by Russia, Austria, and Germany in partitioned Poland. Poland is an agricultural country. More than 3/4 of the Polish people work the land and live in villages, like these Polish farmers who were filmed in the 1930s. Revolve around the church and around the land. Very few Jews lived in the villages of Poland, but still, even in the most remote areas, you could find Jewish families, like the one in these photographs taken in Galicia. Toby Knobel-Pluick is an artist whose drawings and paintings depict her childhood in a village in eastern Galicia. She speaks to us in her apartment in New York City.
It was quite difficult to grow up Jewish in a community because
First of all, I couldn't play with the non-Jewish children, the peasant children. My parents wouldn't let me. And also, they used to harass me, you know, they used to call me names, like, you know, dirty Jew, and different names, you know. And it was a lonely life I had. I had a lonely childhood. So I used to spend a lot of time with my mother. I used to enjoy watching her when she was baking. There was a wood-burning stove, and my job was to clean out the ashes and to sweep the kitchen, the bathroom that we had. I was quite small at the time. I remember when I held that room was just as tall as I was. My father spent a lot of time in the barn, like shredding the wheat and chopping potatoes for the animals. And we used to have peasants that worked for us in the fields. My sister was a dressmaker, so she used to make up blouses for them and skirts, whatever they needed. And we also had a dry goods store. The peasants used to come and buy material, and that way my father paid for the work in the field. When the house was built, they made a Jewish star on the roof. We were proud to be Jews.
But it is here in the town, the shtetl, that we find the traditional centuries-old setting of Jewish life in Poland. Though not all shtetl Jews are pious, the religious conventions are generally accepted. This man is dressed in the traditional style of the Orthodox Jews, which derives in part from the fashions of medieval Polish nobility. Between the 1880s and the 1920s, 1.5 million Jews emigrate from Eastern European towns like this to America. But that road is a two-way street. Those who leave the shtetl take it with them. It is their cultural baggage. Most leave relatives behind with whom they correspond and occasionally return to visit. A few make home movies of their trips, like Gustav Eisner, who took this footage, complete with title cards, to show friends and relatives back home in New York City.
He was a lawyer by profession, wealthy and charitable people. The one who shakes hands is my father, he's the rabbi. On the left is the guest, Mrs. David Shapiro. Next we have his aunt, the altar here, my sister, my mother, and the last, that's me. Very few survived that shtetl. My parents were also killed by Hitler and Mashmoy. And the few that survived, we meet occasionally, we compare old memories. The shtetl was next to a river. This is the river. This is peasants who come into town to buy and to sell.
The peasant's life was very primitive, like they came to the town without shoes, barefoot.
These are already wealthy, you can see on their left. Holodoko was a small place like all the shtetl. kept about 250 or 300 families only.
This was the typical way of carrying water from the well.
Each family, those who could afford, had their own cow, and it provided them with milk, butter, cream. A boy taking a chicken to the shechet, the one who performs the ritual of slaughtering according to Jewish law.
The newer part of the town, I had the fortune or misfortune of being burned down some years before my time, and it was built up again. You had this kind of houses which were more advanced already than the rest of it, you see.
The center of the shtetl was like a square, a big, big square.
In the market day, it was every Tuesday, peasants used to come to buy and to sell their goods, like butter, eggs, chickens, fruit.
This is one of the very distinguished families, and it was a big family with many children and grandchildren. This is the grandfather. His business was, he used to buy wood.
His name was Gershon Katz.
Very learned. Teiro Gdulo B'moke Mechot, they say in Hebrew. It's learning with wealth in one person. And he was also a very wise man. People would like to come and talk to him.
This was family. Like family used to be the way we knew families in those days. Close, very close. Sometimes too close.
Here is the school. The Shapira sent money for the school, so it provided the children with bagel and milk in the morning. That was a daily routine, and this is how they enjoy it. This is at the gravesite of the parents of Mr. and Mrs. Shapira. This is Mr. David Shapiro crying while he says the prayer.
The timeless traditions where the past lives in the present are reflected in these monumental wooden synagogues, the pride of towns that can afford to build them. In modern times, secular movements threaten to shake loose the coming generation from the power of Jewish traditional life.
Father said that not to despair when you see a secular movement in the street, because the Jewish people in their long history had ups and downs, new movements arose, but after a while it evaporated and they came back to their root.
Increasingly in our century, the center of Jewish life shifts to the big cities. The city Jew is often a person in transition, open to new ideas, to a new lifestyle. Roman Eisner speaks to us of this feeling of ambivalence.
I am a Jewish person. I believe, but without the religion. Why should I dress differently than anybody else? Why should I wear a uniform? Not that I'm ashamed to be a Jew. I'm proud to be a Jew, but I don't have to advertise. My home language was Yiddish. My country language was Polish. I had Jewish friends. I had Christian friends too. I have made all our traditional holidays in the house. Otherwise, I'm just like anybody else. That's me, Romanized. I was brought up in Lodz, Poland. As I said, I was born in 1897, September 13th. We were a family, not extremely poor. There was enough to eat, but still poor. Like sometimes when I was younger, I would say, Mama, give me a piece of bread because I'm hungry. She said, like salsa, thirst, a lick of salt, it'll be thirsty. That's about the size of it. This is my brother David's store, engraving and printing. I worked there. I was a printer. That's me helping my brother do something, don't pose for a picture, be natural.
Roman's brother Gustav filmed not only family and friends, but also some of the familiar figures of the Jewish street, popular subjects of photographers of Jewish life.
The blind doctor. He has one remedy for all the sickness. Calcium with a little water, the good cure. This is a carrier. They were carrying loads with the rope on their backs. And they were carrying from one place to the other. They would hire a man, the poorer merchants. And he was carrying the load all day long. This is a Roman carpenter, a tishler, they called it in Yiddish. And he was fixing things by going out in the morning. He didn't know who's going to fix it for and what he's going to fix by. He has his tools with him, and you have to blow a chair or something like this to fix, you know. A man like this went out in the morning, and he thought to myself, well, maybe I'll make a few rubles today. And that's how they ate out the living.
These people who carry their livelihoods on their backs are the poorest, but most visible representatives of the traditional Jewish occupations, handicraft and retail trade. Most city Jews live in or around a courtyard where a good deal of everyday life takes place. Lillian Kleppner lived in such a courtyard in Warsaw as a child. We visit her in her home where she speaks to us in Yiddish, the everyday language of most of the Jews of Eastern Europe.
My name is Gewesen Lila Goldis.
My name was Lila Goldis' daughter.
And the Heim is Gewesen the erste Nummer for my Mutter, Kirschenbaum.
My maiden name was Kirschenbaum.
My Mutter is gewesen a Quadreitschik.
My father was a government supplier.
To the prisoners.
He used to deliver bread to the prisoners in the prison. He knew how to write very well.
Yeah. And my mother had gewesen.
Another house store.
In Boy.
A grocery. Yes. A bread grocery.
And then they gave me a time and I got to talk.
They were busy all day. This is me. I must have been about 8 years old here. I remember they put a box under me so I would look taller. And here is my brother, my two younger brothers, my father, and my mother. The courtyard had doors all around and windows. Everyone had his own entrance. To the courtyard came various barterers, and they would call out, sometimes Gentiles would come in, all kinds of beggars would come, and they would sing, there was every kind of trade. Let's say that across the way was a tailor. He would sit at the machine and sing. There was a cap maker.
Hochstein the Motherlei, the Motherlei, the Commercial of Abstandra, the Commander of the Motherlei. Hochstein the Motherlei.
When the holiday of Sukkot came, booths would be put up on the courtyard. Every man would put up a booth for his family, one right next to the other. And before Passover, everything is washed and taken out and hung out on lines. Everything is aired out. On the first floor, there was a cheder for boys only, no girls. But our doors were always open, so every day I would hear them teaching the children the morning prayer, Moidani.
Moidani, yech dank, lafenechu, padiyel, veimne dankir, meilech, deimailech, chavikayom, oseleipt, aibi, yech dank, deim gott, was erlebt, eibig, meine Schmusi, meine Schumois, mit Abarimkai.
In the large synagogues beyond the Jewish neighborhoods, the prayers are the same, but the sound is different.
This is the Deutsche Schule, they were a Reform temple. And a beautiful choir there. They used to come in carriages, beautiful carriages. A Jew is not supposed to travel on holidays, you know. They were the rich people, the aristocrats.
Though never a part of the landowning class that ruled Poland, there were Jews with considerable economic power in banking, commerce, and industry. A handful lived in great splendor. Some of the earliest factories in the region were built by these Jews. Their connection to the Jewish population was generally through philanthropy. They thought of themselves as Poles of Jewish faith.
This is a picture of me, George Zabad, on the beach in Sopot, a resort on the Baltic. We went there several years in a row. We had a five-room apartment on Pink now, which means beautiful street. My mother was very musical. As a matter of fact, she would have become a singer, except for the fact that Jewish young ladies from upper class Jewish families did not go on the stage or didn't engage in any professional activities. It didn't stop her much later from becoming a professional writer and translator and an editor of a radio magazine. My opinion about Orthodox Jews when I saw them on the streetcar or on the streets of Polish Warsaw was very mixed up. On the one hand, there was contempt, you know, these Jews in foreign dress and all that stuff, and dirty and noisy. On the other hand, I wasn't particularly proud of them, but I did feel that they were my brothers.
Jewish Poland is a world in motion. Traditional ways are called into question. For a century, many educated Jews who see themselves as part of an enlightenment have been absorbing the ideas of the social revolutions of the West. Thinkers and writers emerge with competing visions of a Jewish future that attempt to reconcile modern ideas with the persisting separateness of the Jewish people. The masses of Jews are receptive to these new visions. They are a people who, by tradition, are readers. They are a people who, by tradition, discuss and debate. Ideas matter to them passionately. Even the language itself, Yiddish, Hebrew, Polish, Russian, German, the language in which they choose to argue and write about these new ideas is, in itself, a statement about their vision of the future. Zygmunt Gross, from the city of Krakow, like his father and uncle before him, is a man educated in the liberal traditions of the West, whose vision is international. He speaks to us in Polish.
My ojciec My father was a typical man of the night. I was raised in the atmosphere of progress, equality, respect for men. I was always opting for cooperation between all ethnic groups. I always thought that all kinds of racial divisions is against the basic conception of civilization. Jews appear in Poland very early. Historical sources indicate the 9th and 10th century they were already in Poland. Thus, Jews were building, in fact, Polish culture and civilization. In particular, town culture, industry, for those reasons. I didn't think that there is a conflict between the Jews and the Poles. In particular, in Galicia, in circles related to Polish intelligentsia.
It is
a mistaken feeling
that
Jews in France, for instance, do not feel as Frenchmen,
that
in Germany they don't feel to be German,
and
that in Poland they didn't feel to be Polish.
This commitment to universalism is opposed by the much more popular views of the Zionists.
For a long, long time, I was brought up to enjoy the notion of giving my blood and even my life for Poland, which treated me as a second-class citizen. The way I like to describe it is that when I, as a boy or a young man, would open my mouth and speak my kind of Polish, which classifies a Pole even more than the English classifies an Englishman, to borrow the Pygmalion My Fair Lady analogy. And the way I was dressed, and the way I looked, the Pole, whether if he was a worker or a janitor, would immediately take off his cap because it was a highly stratified society. But if he found out in the next 3 minutes that I was a Jew, he might just spit on me. And I didn't change at all during those 3 minutes. I went to a Polish gymnasium, which was, however, attended largely by Jews. There was always this underlying tension of not belonging to either world completely. And the majority of the Jewish students in later years, you know, when we were in our teens, were all in the same boat I was in, and became Zionists like I did.
The Zionists argue that the future of the Polish Jew is to build a modern Jewish state in their ancient homeland in Palestine. And the Jews should speak not Yiddish and not Polish, but their ancient national language, Hebrew.
My father was a fanatic about Hebrew. When he married my mother, this was a condition that they will speak to their children Hebrew. And I didn't know another language, being a small child. No, but he couldn't grow up with children in a thinking way. I went outside and then I learned Yiddish when I played with children. The girl with the braids, that's me. But at home, we used to speak Hebrew and I knew many poems by heart. Bianik, for instance, I remember, it was in Hebrew. The first song, El Hatzipor, the Ike speaks to the bird. Shalom Rav Shuveich Tzipora Nechmedet Me'arzo Sachom El Haloni El Koleich Ki Orev Manafshi Koloso Bahoreth Ve'ozveich Me'oni. The meaning is that the young poet is very sad sitting in the diaspora. He would like to be in Israel, just like this bird, and to fly to the country where summer is everlasting.
there are Jewish nationalists who are critical of the Zionists, who argue that the Jews of the diaspora, the Jewish dispersion, are a nation with a history as well as a land right where they are, in the cities and towns of Eastern Europe. Sophie Dubnoferlich speaks to us in Yiddish and in Russian about her father, Shimon Dubnov, a leading proponent of this position.
For him, the negative aspect of Zionism was the legend, the myth of territory. From the history of the Jews of Poland, he learned that Jews are a spiritual nation. He was an anti-territorialist, and indeed a patriot of the Jewish exile, a patriot of the diaspora. He felt that Jewish life is here. We should concentrate all our efforts on our life here. The principle of here-ness, that was for him the meaning of Jewish life and history. The active groups of the Jewish diaspora conducted a struggle for national rights.
Диаспора – это наше историческое наследство в течение...
Diaspora is our national inheritance, heritage of 2,000 years.
В течение... Да. В это время мы много взяли от окружающих...
In that period, we gained a lot from the world around us.
И мы много дали окружающим.
And we gave a lot to the world around us.
This vision of Jewish life, which affirms the diaspora, carries with it the idea that Yiddish, the everyday Jewish language of Eastern Europe, is the proper vehicle of national expression. One of the major literary figures before World War I is Yud Lamed Peretz, who nurtures a whole generation of Yiddish writers. Young Jewish writers from all over Poland come to his home in Warsaw and become his disciples. After the war, Yiddish writing blossoms with new energy. Yiddish writers and journalists join associations. Young writers come together in the large cities of Poland to argue, to read to each other, sign manifestos, print magazines, to translate and absorb the literatures of other European languages while creating a large body of literature in their own. In Vilna, there is Young Vilna. In Warsaw, there is The Gang, a group that takes its name from a poem written in 1897 by Moshe Brodersen.
We youth, we're a joyous gang bursting with song, and we're going on unknown roads. In these days, melancholy days, in these nights of terror, through hardships to the stars. But the way that leads to the stars is hard. Hey, think a little less. What is destined will come true. Joy will be fruitful and multiply. In the meantime, bears are dancing through hardships to the stars. We're off, going on unknown roads. In these days, melancholy days, in these nights of terror, we youth, a joyous gang bursting with song.
Nights of terror are upon Europe. This map that is held fast for over a century is about to be changed. 3.5 million Jews scattered in the towns and cities throughout these territories and living under antagonistic empires are hurtled into World War I. Jewish soldiers find themselves wearing the uniforms of opposing armies. There are Jews in the Russian army. There are Jews in the Austrian army. There are Jews in the German army. There are Jews in the newly reformed Polish legions whose soldiers fight against Russia with an eye on liberating Poland. destruction and dislocation.
Oi Gott hat gemacht alle Humale, so kosten zwei Worte Saboid. Wir essen nicht, wir trinken nicht, wir schlucken nicht Pfannach. Oi zu aller du Naschie. Ach lieber Gott, was hast du gemacht? Die Option Rachmun ist auf mir.
There were literally thousands of orphans left as a result of the war. Families were broken up. A large part of the population was dependent upon soup kitchens.
People came back after the war. If they had already something in the house, there was everything taken away. There was nothing.
I am Henry Rubindicht. I am born in Warsaw in 1897, the 13th of December. We grew up as Polish citizens. We got obligations.
The victors redraw the map of Europe. The Polish Republic is signed into existence on paper.
In 1990 December, they called me to the army. Piłsudski was the leader. He was a patriot. He fought for Poland. He was my commander. And this time, I was in love with a beautiful girl. She was my love, Miss Pauline Rubinstein. She was old 16 years. I was older than she was. And I had to go to the front on the battlefield. She came to me to tell me goodbye. The sun set down, it was a red sky, and we took her in the arms, we create a sign for us for a goodbye in Polish. Niech mój śpiew ocnej ciszy wzruszy serce twe. Ach ty miła moja luba, choć pobięcia me.
Fears that Russia will once again be a threat to its freedom.
When Poland fight for her freedom, we was interested to fight together with the Polish for our freedom. But when the Polish army was surrounded by the Bolsheviks, then was rumors that the Jewish people are traitors. And so General Haller, he gave the orders to all Jewish from the battlefield to concentrate in one camp. It was Jablonka. We was prisoners, close to 10,000 soldiers. My obóz Jablonka, nadzieja strasznie płonna, na dwór rzucono nas jak śmieci wór, na dwór, na dwór.
Officially, these soldiers were exonerated after a fight in the parliament. But Jews begin to realize that their enemies are more powerful than their friends. Jews enjoy the legal rights of all Polish citizens. They vote in national elections, elect members to the parliament. As a minority, they are given the right to elect their own local governing boards. But things are bad on both the Polish street and the Jewish street. The destruction caused by the war and the loss of Poland's traditional Russian markets create enormous poverty, particularly in the small towns, whose economic role has long been in decline. These Jews, lining up for visas, are among the last to emigrate freely. The doors to America virtually close in 1924, and other countries adopt the same closed-door policies. Anti-Semitism, rooted in a thousand-year history of economic, social, and religious differences, is inflamed by poverty. Anti-Jewish riots, known as pogroms, break out, particularly in small towns. Bertha Frost Zaltz grows up in the small town of Kovishev. She speaks to us of her odyssey to a wider world.
In May 1919, they start out pogroming in Poland, start those big pogroms. Our town too was very bad hit. Was again another story that everybody had nothing. I decided for myself that I'm leaving the house, going. Where? The nearest, biggest place was Krakow. Imagination, it was the right world. But there was a problem of shoes. It was December and I didn't have shoes. My father managed to buy a piece of leather to make soles. My brother had brought home a military coat, and from this piece of material he left from the military coat, we made the top of the shoes. I came to Krakow the beginning of January 1920. It was a very severe winter at that time.
I had sisters in Krakow and relatives.
After 2 weeks in a certain factory, I got a job. My aim was to work and to go to school in Krakow.
I was living in a Hasidic environment. Very careful, they should know that I'm not observing Sabbath. I took different lessons Saturday, like English, like music, like painting, and so on. So I was busy all day Shabbos too, but nobody knew about it. This quest for wider horizons becomes, in other circles, an open and organized way of life, and not at all separate from being Jewish.
I grew up in a religious home. My parents were religious people. My father believed in God, but he didn't believe in the rabbi. God is God, and the rabbi is the man. And second, everybody can do what he wants. That's not his business. His business with God is his business. Traditional people in Vilna could understand that a new generation grows up. The tradition was going parallel to the secular life. Not losing too much. For example, you had behind that synagogues, each professional, he had his own synagogue. Every Friday night, all children who were very anti-religious, which I said, all Zionists, labor Zionists, communists, from Ratzayel, and all the five boys and one girl. And but Friday night, everybody was on the meal, to have the meal. On Saturday at 12 o'clock, everybody was at the shop to have the meal together with your father. I went to the synagogue every Saturday with my father, till Bar Mitzvah. But the young generation already, secular life took over in Vilna between the First World War and the Second World War. It was the golden age of secular Jewish culture in Vilna. That's a job in the new world. Put a foundation for the new building. So we collected everything what is connected with Jewish life, with Jewish history. We had great Jewish scholars. That's Dr. Zalot Shabbat, Dr. Weinreich, Chirikov, founders of Tivo. A lot of poets, we had a lot of writers, we had workers who were interested in the Yiddish life, Yiddish culture. And for us, Jewish culture was one of the, like you go to a temple, that's our God, that's our creation from centuries. And everybody of us felt that we are part of that. For example, I remember going around and collecting all kind of folklore, and everybody was proud to have an organization like the Evo. That's me. On the left, Shlomo Kowalski.
This adaptation of modern models to the needs of the Jewish community, this was a part of this cultural revolution that was going on, in which Vilna participated and was perhaps pioneering to some extent. One example would be a special school for mentally disturbed children.
It was unusual. That was one woman, she was a great psychologist, Vita Levin, and she decided to treat children, retarded children, so they can learn something, and to organize a school for them. Then I had a school for children from the street.
Jewish juvenile delinquents, which the courts would turn over. Another example would be Montessori-type schools, of which, yes, in Vilna. In fact, I myself attended a Montessori kindergarten. At a time when such institutions, not only in Poland, but even in Western Europe, were very rare. Our teachers who traveled abroad, who obtained their education abroad, came back to serve the masses, to serve the lower classes of the Jewish population.
That's one of the summer camps for very poor children from the Yiddish schools.
When Vilna became a Polish city, the official language became Polish. It was not a big problem for the bulk of the Jewish population linguistically, because they were always Yiddish speaking. It was also not a big problem for us children. We were young enough to learn Polish. But it was a problem for my parents. The switchover wasn't easy for them, and they never learned Polish as well as they spoke Russian. This was the time when new horizons opened up for Yiddish. We were sent to Yiddish schools, and we attended first the elementary school and then the high school.
I went to the Yiddish gymnasium, that means a high school, and everything except Polish language, Polish history, Polish literature was taught in Yiddish. Everything you learn in a high school, mathematics, chemistry, geography, Yiddish literature, physics, what more you have, gym in Yiddish, play basketball in Yiddish.
But we paid a price for it. Our diploma was not recognized by the educational institutions, and I had to spend additional 2 years in a Polish teaching high school in order to earn my diploma and be admitted to a university.
It was a difficult transition because my thinking was everything in Yiddish. And you come to a Polish society where you have to start thinking in Polish. But you learn those, you have to learn those. Because you lived in Poland and you are Polish a little.
The Polish and foreign universities provide a small but growing number of Jews a doorway to the professions and the arts. Henryk Rubelit, who himself becomes a businessman, remembers the promising careers of his brothers and sisters.
This is my brother Felix. He was a sculptor, a student of Dunikowski, the great Polish sculptor. Also the teacher in the school, in the Polish school, in the medical sanatorium. He teach them arts and crafts. This is my sister Halina. She was in university and she finished the doctor in bacteriology. She got the bacteriology laboratory. This was in Warsaw. This is her husband. He was a businessman. He was together with the laboratory. This is my younger sister, Natalia. She is wonderful. She finished her education as painter, as sculptor, and she created a school theater for the youth. For the future, that youth will be educated in arts, poetry, theater. They called it the Musa. Every week was a matinee for the children. And she made stage designs for this student theater. This is my sister Bellarina. When she was young, she was a teacher in gymnasium. This was very interesting. In the First War, a German created courses on Yiddish for Jewish teachers. And among them, you got Bella Bellarina. And this time, she was Bella. Then, she got a feeling to go on the stage. Bella Bellarina, she is born with a talent. Very talented. She does. She feel her life belonged to the stage. And she was the star in a young Yiddish theater. This is Schneier from the Vilno Tuba when they come to Warsaw. When he saw Bellarina, he followed after. My father was against theater. He was in real estate and he was arbitrator in a Jewish court. In general, religious Jews don't accept theater. My sister was afraid to be on the stage. She knows that my father don't allow to be an actress. So she changed her stage name, Bella Bellarina. So nobody else was Bella Bellarina. And she played this name with the Vilna troupe. Then come the time they decide to marry. She runs a bit too large and they married. So her friends in the union gave whole page with big ads in the newspaper, Chaim Schneier buried Bella Bellarina Rubinlich. My father read the newspaper and I find out she's the actress, she runs a written play. It was a tragedy in the family. He suffered so much. But years later, they played the Dibu. Bellarina played the dance of death. And the critics, newspaper, like it. Then he comes to the debut in theater. They was very, they like it. So then he accepted, they had got a choice as his daughter, and they start to come to the theater. He was very happy later.
The productions of Yiddish theaters range from original Yiddish plays like Prerequisite at Night at an Old Marketplace, and translations from the European stage, like Ibsen's Ghosts, to the music and comedy of popular theater.
We went to the Yiddish theater, and we came home. We had a taste of everything. Everyone knew a little bit, and we sang. A girl would come on the stage,
bare. An die Käse mit mir zu rissen. In den Bobes nackt heißt er mir gein, euch gein. Euren Dreußen geht der Regen. Euren Dreußen geht der Regen. In Preußen geht der Regen mit der kleinen bisschen Schnee. Der Jungen will gar nicht wissen, aber die Schierhaler sind mir zu rissen. In Bobis Nacket heißt er mir gern, oh, ich gern. Der Jungen ist mir bekannt, in der Jungen ist mir bekannt. Der Jungen ist mir bekannt mit meinem kleinen Stickelebräu. Er will kein gar nicht wissen. Ah, die Käschen ist mir zerrissen. In Oiskein will ich barrennt in ihr neu. Heute neu.
A large audience hungry for Yiddish theater supports the growth of hundreds of amateur and professional troupes. Many theater companies, even the most famous such as the Vilna Troupe and Ida Kaminska's Warsaw Yiddish Art Theater, travel and perform their repertoires all over Jewish Poland. Even in the smallest towns, there is an opportunity to see a big city theater company.
Once came to Sokoli Turkov, a famous Jewish artist. The play was named The 41. It was about the struggle between the white and the red in Russia after the civil war there. It was about a red commander, a woman, and she had to guard one prisoner, a white. And while guarding him, they fall in love. But she had to kill him. And it was for her terrible, because she loved him very much. But in spite of her feelings to him, she had to follow the command, and she killed him. Before him, she killed 40. And this was the 41st shooting. And it impressed us very much. And I remember we used to discuss between us, the children, was she right or wrong? Is it the right way or not? What is more important, her own feelings or the idea of a member of the Communist Party? We were then young and excited about her, that she was so smart and faithful to her ideas.
A whole generation is growing up faithful to its ideas. Jewish life, traditionally highly organized around charity, education, and work, becomes even more highly organized. Alongside the old-style one-room school are modern classrooms and vocational schools for women. Alongside the traditional games of the Jewish street are organized recreational activities. At weddings, you could hear the traditional town band. In the street, the organizational marching band. In the concert hall, a Jewish symphony orchestra. You might find an exotic costume at a Hasidic celebration or on a movie set of the growing Jewish film industry. More and more, the ideas that generate organizations are political. Ideological competition is fierce. In the growing Jewish working class, socialism, in all its varieties, gains more and more support. It combines with different national visions. There are Torah socialists. There are Zionist socialists. There are communists. There are Bundists. The Bund is an anti-Zionist labor party that combines an affirmation of the Jewish diaspora with a socialist program.
Ideologically, I became a socialist when I turned 18. And after the first revolution, I decided that one cannot become politically active individually or in small groups. To become politically active, one must become a member of a party. When I joined the Bund, it was a revolutionary party.
I met Henrich in the Bundes student group at the university.
This student group at the university in St. Petersburg at the turn of the century, like other small groups of activists in East European universities, is, 20 years later, part of the leadership of a mass movement in Poland.
I came to Poland at the end of 1918. Poland, at the moment of gaining its independence and after the First World War, was a very poor country.
And especially low was the economic level of the Jewish working masses.
In Poland, the Bund really became a mass movement, a people's movement. And truly, a party of the working masses.
My name is Chaim Ellenbaum. I was born in Warsaw in 1915. I worked as a carpenter. I belonged to the Bund, and our hopes were socialist hopes. One of the main activities of the Bund was connected to trade unions. The unions were concerned with the welfare of their members. But at the same time, they took part in all political actions which the Bund initiated. The leadership of the unions were mostly Bundists, and many union members came through the unions to the Bund. This man organized those supporters, and those people, some of them became very dedicated. Even they came from the rough and tough people, a lot of them were formerly underworld people, became dedicated. And they were the ones who usually went out when there was fighting to do. In many cases where people were evicted from their apartments for not paying rent. There were cases when police came and threw them out, and the Bundes militia came and put them back in their apartments. The activities of the Bund took in all aspects of life. There was amateur groups, theater groups, literary evenings. Another aspect of the movement was outings, organized to the ocean, in the mountains. There were libraries organized by the Bund. And Warsaw was called the Warsaw Library. This library played a big role, I would say, in my own life, because not everybody could afford books. And through that library, we got acquainted with world literature. I remember as a boy I used to read Roland, the French Barbie, German Toller, I recall, Russian literature, even Scandinavian like Axel Monte, and so on. American was Upton Sinclair, and all those books were lent out from the library for minimal monthly payment. There was a summer camp organized by YAF, an organization formed by the Bund for Jewish working class women. The helpers are photographed here with the two leaders of the Bund, Victor Alter and Henrik Ehrlich. I am sitting next to Ehrlich. It was quite an honor to sit near those leaders of the Bund. Us, especially when we were so young and looked up to them. To be a member of the Bund was to start a new way of life. Flag here. I have here my friends.
Here
parties helps to sustain Jewish Poland. Like the Bund, each party seeks to create a whole new way of life for its members. The Zionist movement appeals to the full sweep of the Jewish social spectrum. Its political expression ranges from the revisionists on the right to the labor Zionists on the left. Unique to the Zionist movement is the kibbutz, an agricultural collective aimed at preparing Jewish youth to resettle the land in Palestine.
The proposition was that by building Israel, we can just be merchants and wheelers and dealers and middlemen, but we have to start with the land and do every job all by ourselves without taking any Arabs or whoever it is to work for us. So they used to prepare the Jewish youth to do all kinds of manual work, work on the farm, all kinds of hard labor that they found.
By the 1930s, there are dozens of kibbutzim and other similar training settlements throughout Poland.
It looks like we look for the labor to be the harder, the better, so we more suitable later to come to Israel and work.
We already lived in a life above our life. Our mind was not where we lived. Our mind was where we taught to live. In Palestine, because the organizations we were always affiliated with, Ashomer HaTzair, Gordonia, Poi Alitzion, all our free time was just consumed in our happiness to be in those organizations. During our school in the evenings, after our homework, during our free days, and during our vacations, we went to camps. I was particularly privileged. I was working for Gordonin, I traveled all over Poland.
And I used to write a column, you know, about the meaning of kibbutz. In my particular way, I didn't write this ideologically. I wrote it always in the romantic sense, which a kibbutz was romantic, should have been romantic. To be happy with nothing. I was traveling from kibbutz, to observe. See, if people are learning to live together. Because after all, you know, it was an experiment.
The most prominent arena for the Zionist movement in Poland is in electoral politics. Zionist parliamentary leaders, such as Professor Moses Shor, Rosa Pomerantz Meltzer, and leader of the General Zionists, Yitzhak Greenbaum, are viewed as spokesmen for the Jewish community as a whole. Though there is an Orthodox Zionist party, the Mizrahi, the more powerful political expression of Jewish Orthodoxy is the anti-Zionist Agudas Israel party.
I was political secretary of the Agudas Israel in Poland. This was the right wing of the political life. For instance, the Zionists fought more radically against the government. In the parliament, in the press. So Guda was more moderate, more restrained. It's not politically. Religious, this is of course, while the other parties were secular, this was a religious party. In social terms, that was a party of merchants, businessmen, storekeepers. They were a power, but a silent power, dispersed power, disorganized. And since this was an innovation, and every innovation was under suspicion by Orthodox Jews who adhered strictly to tradition, and nothing that didn't happen before should happen now. So, in the beginning, there was an opposition. But one man, one leader, This was a Ger Rebbe, Rabbi Abraham Mordechai Alter, Zecher Tzaddik Livracha. He accepted the idea.
The Rebbe of Ger was the most powerful of the many Hasidic leaders of Jewish Poland. Hasidism had become the dominant mode of Jewish Orthodoxy. The charismatic leaders of Hasidic sects established dynasties, and some of the Hasidic courts had the regal appearance of this palace of the chart-cover Rebbe. The Rebbe of Ger was more widely traveled than other Rebbes, and his wider horizons enabled him to bring innovations to the Neo-Orthodox movement. For example, summer camps for the boys of the Cheder were established. And girls, who had been traditionally excluded from religious education, were enrolled in a network of afternoon schools called Beis Yankov. Claire Yeltsin attended such a school in her native town of Russell. She remembers the effect it had on her and her friends.
What it gave us children and young people was a good Jewish education and a sense of pride. You see, in the public school, there was antagonism from a good many of the teachers and from the Gentile students. Mostly, not all, but mostly. And here in the Jewish school, it was Hamish. It was home. It was ours. I liked my friends. I enjoyed the social life in my town, the movements. For instance, in the Jewish scene, the movements, the Zionist movement, the Neo-Orthodox movement was all represented. There were what they call Verein, clubs. And there would be a Mizrahi and a revisionist and a labor Zionist, and there was, I think, even one communist in the town. I must say that the young people in my town, and this was true of the rest of Poland, they were active. Probably it was the best youth that the Jewish people ever had.
Yeah, mein Lieber, das wird kein Guss nicht geben. Du bringst mit deiner Gschonne mich von Geduld heraus. Du musst dich lernen tanzen, ich schwör bei unser Leben. Aber nicht ins Heimschwein mit uns aus. Mag sich sein, was du bist, ein verbrennter Zionist. Ab und da wird's weimen, geht es so. Alle ist seit der Zeit und auch die gute Leid tanzen Tango und Charleston. Kollege, tanzen, schäm dich nicht. Ich will dich führen, Tritt bei Tritt. Stell dich, mein Lieber, hat gegenüber und hieb zusammen mit mir um. Fest darum, ich leg ihr Kräun, das weißt du sicher, kennst du schon. Jetzt lass mich schweben, ach Sarah leben, wenn's dann zervor und alles tun.
Marschalek Josef Ilsutski, Życie Zakończy.
I remember Pilsudski's funeral, at the funeral of his heart, which took place in Vilna, very well. The funeral procession was marching through the street where we lived and then out to the outskirts of the city. This was the street where we used to walk during our holidays or weekends with the parents, and it looks so beautiful, green and peaceful, but this time it had a feeling of something foreboding, as if a bad time was coming.
Thank you.
know, the headlines from around the world, they were very, very days of crisis, international crisis. World War II closed in already. Bloom departed, the Prime Minister of the People's Front in France. Edouard Deladier became Prime Minister. And whatever changes came, they never say something good for the Jew. Oh, it's not good. It's not good for us. Because if the world changes, we feel it.
After the death of Pilsudski, and with fascist regimes coming to power all over Europe, anti-Semitic elements grow bolder in Poland. Jews are attacked more relentlessly than before, and on all fronts, in the streets and the parks, at the ballot box, in the marketplace.
But say in business, they used to put pickets not allowed into Jewish stores, and beat up the non-Jews who come into a Jewish store to buy some goods.
At the time of Hitler's rise, at the rise of anti-Semitism in Poland, they tried to pass a law not to allow kosher slaughter.
There was a fight in the parliament. This united every segment of Jewish parties, from the Bund to the Aguda. Between the Zionists, the Volkists, the Democrat Party, every party was united because they considered this not only a religious matter, but it was a straight anti-Semitic onslaught against Jews.
But say for 1,500 Jews, they allowed only two cattle to be slaughtered ritually.
My father, being a chazan, the cantor and shofet who prepares the ritual slaughtering, was forbidden to do it anymore, and being that the Jewish people were very religious and they had to have their kosher meat, he used to go out in the middle of the night to do it, and the government used to follow him around, police. We had a maid that used to go out with my father and take away the knife from him, and one time he was caught, and they would have arrested him, but they couldn't find the knife with him, so it was a blessing.
And in 1936, when I came to the university, the influence from Hitler in Germany was already very strong in Poland, and Polish students, the reactionaries, National Democrats, they call themselves, start to fight the Jewish students. They don't let them in the classes, for example. And later on, they decided we cannot sit together with them. They decided for us to make separate benches on the left side. But we decided we won't sit on the left side. So we were standing the whole lectures listening to the professors or sitting on the floor, but not to sit on the left side. And we fought with them. We made one a hunger strike. We closed up in our student body, in their place, and we were sitting there for 8 hours, not eating. And then a lot of people came. I remember it was on the fourth floor. You could see that our parents came to see if we were alive. Like I said, Dr. Shabbat, the old Jewish leaders came to talk to us, but we didn't let in anybody. The only thing what we let in, through the window, you got water, I remember, with a bottle, a pail. We let down a pail, and it gave us some water only to drink, because we didn't have water in there.
What was the purpose of that?
To protest. We thought maybe we can do something against the beatings, against the the hooliganism, let's say.
There is no such thing as black and white. In a way, life became harder. But at the same time, the inner life of the Jewish population became more intensive and more rich. It was a life in spite of poverty, in spite of anti-Semitism, of striving for something better.
This is footage of the town of Zarum in central Poland, taken in the 1930s. On July 17, 1937, the directors of the Jewish Children's Library in Zarum write a letter discussing their decision to build a new building. They mention the doubts of those who say, "We will soon have to leave Zarum." But this, the letter goes on, is only a vacillating opinion of weak individuals. The great majority agreed that indeed in this time when the material situation is so bad, we must create the possibility that our cultural center be able to last through the crisis and exert ourselves to assure that the spiritual level of the youth not fall. All over Poland, Jews struggle for the future of their children. With financial aid from American Jews, they maintain a large number of health and educational institutions. Some are run according to the latest educational theories and become widely known outside of Poland, such as this orphanage, directed by the writer of children's books, Dr. Janusz Korczak. This footage is from a documentary film made in 1936 about another such institution, the Medical Sanitarium near Warsaw.
It was an institution established by the Jewish Socialist Bund to give children who were at a high risk of tuberculosis, to give them a rest, to give them better nourishment for a certain time. It later on developed into also educational institution. There was excursions into the neighboring villages to see what's going on, what kind of life nature has, and picking up some new species for the small, shall we call it, natural history museum. The ideas were those of social justice and equality, but at the same time, the individuality of the children, of every child, was brought out and was valued. There was a lot of humor. Also reports on what was going on in the outside world. Sanatorium was a dream world. There was a certain ideal, there was a longing to improve oneself and to improve society.
The dreams of these children of Jewish Poland will never have the chance to be either realized or frustrated. The tiny number of children who will grow up will find themselves starting over in strange countries.
When I was younger, my brother was always trying to get me up to America to go. But I didn't care too much to go to America. I was doing pretty well for myself and as a I was single and I was happy, so I didn't care to go. But 10 years later, the Hitler era was in full bloom, and we left to go from America. This was 1938. Before we left, we went to the cemetery to say goodbye to our people. It was a custom to do that, because, you know, you never knew that you were ever going to come back here to see them. Matter of fact, I never did. And riding the trolley car, there was a Gentile fellow. He says to me, "You see those buildings? Those buildings belongs to the Jews, and the street belong to us." He said, "There'll be a time pretty soon. Those buildings belong to us, and that you'll be out of the city."
Very few Jews leave Poland in the 1930s. Emigration has become too difficult and too expensive. Most Jews are absorbed in the struggle to survive and in their day-to-day lives.
This was taken in August 1939, the tragic year when Jewish life in Vilna was on the eve of complete destruction. But we didn't know anything about it at that time. And this picture just portrays a happy family in the country. My uncle is director of the Technikum at the Ort. His son, who together with his father perished in 1943 in the concentration camp of Estonia. Then my mother embracing her little niece who already went to Yiddish schools and studied the poetry of Sutskever. My mother was also killed in 1943 in Majdanek or Treblinka. I'm afraid to find out even where. And then me, I was then graduated from the university and trying to get some kind of a job in pre-war Poland.
That might have happened elsewhere. How genocide in Armenia might have affected the whole Armenian psyche. You will hear from Matilde Mukhadevana about how that country is struggling now to rebuild itself. And I also hope that you will think also about the people who are dying in Darfur and in the Congo, and perhaps in other places that we don't know about. Anybody have any questions or any clarification? There's a lot of information sent to you, but there was some that was, shall we say, reinforcing what we've already learned. We learned about the effects of nationalism after World War I, and you got some of your terms answered as well, the important terms, like shtetl in Yiddish.